Here we are again, and I guess we didn't expect to be in lockdown again, but I thank God that the technology exists for us to not give up the habit of meeting together, like Paul said. I want us to launch a series that I'm calling Angels in the Architecture, and I have this very unusual painting by a lady called Christine Keogh called Blue Angels as the background for it, and I'll talk a little bit more about why later on. But I want us to have a look at a story from the Bible that's a story about angelic visitors, about broken dreams made new, and about a kingdom being born. And I'm going to read the first few verses from the first chapter of a book in the Bible, and just as I read it, I wonder if you can tick through in your head and work out which book it's coming from. This is chapter 1 and verse 1. It says this: "Many have undertaken to draw up an account of the things that have been fulfilled among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who from the first were eyewitnesses and servants of the word. With this in mind, since I myself have carefully investigated everything from the beginning, I too decided to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know the certainty of the things you've been taught." Does that ring any bells for you? Yeah, it's the Gospel of Luke. And like I very often say, when we're going to look at material from a book in the Bible in a consistent way, it's good to start with the introductory material you'd find in any good commentary. We talk about the date and the authorship of that book. Most times when people start, especially this Christmas services that we've all just had, they start from Luke chapter 2. But actually, Luke chapter 1 is rich. The events in this chapter read like the plot of a young adult fantasy movie. There's a childless couple, a lucky draw, an evil king, an angelic visit, a curse, a prophecy, all in the verses from 5 to 25. We're going to have a look at that material close up, but we know that the book of Luke was written quite early. There's two suggested dates, one between 59 to 63 AD and one somewhere in the 70s AD but before 80. So we know that this book was written within 30 years of Jesus' death and resurrection. It's addressed to Theophilus, a Greek name that comes from two words, theos meaning God and philios meaning a lover. So it's one who loves God. And the author calls him O Most Excellent Theophilus, which indicates he was a wealthy, probably Roman official, possibly Luke's patron. That sort of dedication was common in letters written at that time. Luke has another nickname for himself that comes from the authorized translation's take on Colossians 4. He's often called the beloved physician. And if you have a look at it in the AV, that's what you'll read. He was probably a Gentile. He was very well educated, an articulate man, and his writing is some of the highest quality Greek in the scriptures. He was a doctor and a companion of Paul until his imprisonment in Rome, which you read about in 2 Timothy. He wrote two books, the Gospel of Luke and its sequel, Acts of the Apostles. In fact, Luke wrote more than any other writer of the New Testament. It's kind of surprising, isn't it? Paul wrote more books, but Luke wrote more content. In fact, the two books that go together, Luke and the Acts of the Apostles, some scholars treat them as one unit and call it Luke Acts. Interesting, isn't it? He's a great writer, and there's some things he focuses on more than the other Gospels do. You get more medical details in the miracles because Luke, as a doctor, picked up on those things. He has an emphasis on women. He names them and describes them in ways the other Gospels don't. There's an emphasis on prayer and on evangelism. Overall, he's a meticulous guy. You get details, like in the account we're going to read, you'll have a look at how the angel was standing to the right of the altar. It's just those sort of details that indicate to us that Luke went back and interviewed these people. He talked to them and wrote down this material. So let's have a look at the verses from 5 to 25. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were righteous in the sight of God, observing all the law's commands and decrees blamelessly. But they were childless because Elizabeth was not able to conceive, and they were both very old. Once, when Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time came for the burning of incense, all the assembled worshippers were praying outside. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I'm an old man and my wife is well along in years." The angel said to him, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I've been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. When he came out, he could not speak to them. They realized he had seen a vision in the temple, but he kept making signs to them, but remained unable to speak. When his time of service was completed, he returned home. After this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. "The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days he has shown his favour and taken away my disgrace among the people." What a lovely thing to say. This chapter, Luke has obviously gone and interviewed Zechariah, and it's the story of Zechariah and Elizabeth. We know a few things about him. We get told that he's very old, that he's a priest, and you remember these two roles that you read about in the Old Testament, a prophet and a priest. A prophet represents God to mankind. He says, "Hear the word of the Lord, this is what God says." But a priest represents mankind to God. The priest comes before God with the offerings. He brings the incense and the burnt sacrifices, and he says to God, "Oh Lord, forgive us our sins." So that was Zechariah's role. He was a priest. He was righteous, and so was Elizabeth. They were childless, and it was his turn. That's kind of interesting. One scholar that I read said that at the time of the writing of this story, there would have been about 18,000 priests among the people of Israel, something like that, of the line of Aaron, who were eligible between certain ages. You know, there was sort of like a pension age. There was a cutoff period. And in that time, they were eligible to act as priests in the temple. They were trained and ready for it. But they weren't allowed to just go do it whenever they liked. There was a rotating roster. And every year, each division had 2 weeks. And by lot, from the thousands in that division, they drew out maybe four or five names, some small number of names, who took their turn for that two-week period as being priests in front of the Lord in the temple. And Zechariah was old. All his career life, all the training and preparation he'd had, all the privileges, that is, high pedigree as a descendant of Aaron and as married to a descendant of Aaron, all those things made him available to be a priest and to work before God in the temple, but he never got chosen. All his life, his name was not the one that came out. And that must have happened for lots of people. And now he was old. I think it's very likely that Zechariah felt like he missed out, like it was never going to happen for him, like he'd never get to go into the temple and offer the priest and represent the people to God. The job that they were doing was to burn incense, And that was one of the tasks of a priest. There were two altars in the old temple. There was a really big one for burning sacrifices in an outer courtyard. And you went into an inner courtyard, and right inside that was the Holy of Holies, where the priest, any priest, was only allowed once a year. There was a big curtain, and just in front of that curtain was the altar of incense. It was smaller, and it was covered entirely in gold. It was very beautiful. And the priest went in there, and he took with him incense and oil, and he burned them on that altar right in front of the great curtain that separated all people from the Holy of Holies and the presence of God. The incense is interesting. It wasn't just anything. You didn't just go out and pick something that smelled good. There was a recipe for it, and you can read about it in the book of Exodus, chapter 30 and verse 34. It describes the priestly role. It describes what the priest is going to do. The basic perfume they took was frankincense. There's some resin and some gum that goes with it to make it portable and burnable and so that it works well. But basically, it was frankincense. And you can also read there about the oil they took with them, which came from myrrh. And the altar on which they burned incense was covered entirely with gold. Do the hairs on the back of your neck prickle? Gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Does it ring a bell for you? Any priest who went in there, and on this occasion, Zechariah, who finally, his name was chosen by Lot, finally he comes in to represent the people to God. In his role, he is bringing gold and frankincense and myrrh together in that one moment, in that one place. And within a couple of years of him doing that, wise men will come, bearing gold and frankincense and myrrh. God's detail, his attention to detail, the precise way he's weaving together the facts of Zechariah's behavior, of the prophecy he sees, of the work that he does in the temple, and of the coming of Jesus is extraordinary. The other thing Luke's account reveals to us is that Zechariah was startled and fearful. So he's the priest, he's gone into the temple to speak to God on behalf of the people. And when an angelic visitor arrives, he's startled and full of fear. I guess we need to remember that this happened, this gospel marks the end of what we call the intertestamental period, the gap between the end of the Old Testament and the start of the New, as recorded in the Gospels. There's an 800-year gap there when the people of God, the Hebrew people, the people of Israel, heard nothing. No prophet spoke, God sent them no messages for 800 years from the time of his father and his grandfather and his great-grandfather and his great-great, and you just go back and back and back into Zechariah's history. And for all of the people, for all of those years, no one heard from God. And when Zechariah went into the temple, he did not expect an angelic visitor. Nobody did. None of the priests did. None of the people of Israel did. For generations, their experience had been that you went in and you did this stuff that your great, 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 greats had been told about. But way back then, when the temple was first designed, when Moses first built the tabernacle in the desert and the temple that Solomon built, people did expect to meet God. They did expect to bump into him in the temple. There was this shining glory in there. When Moses bumped into God, his face glowed. There were people afraid of meeting God because it was an awesome and terrifying experience. It was overwhelming. It could be at the risk of your life that you bumped into God. And people who went into the original temple expected God to be there and for things to happen. Early on in the temple worship, the priests who went once a year within that curtain did so with a rope around their belly that trailed outside. People expected that they would confront God there and they would die and they'd have to use the rope to haul their corpse out so that they themselves would not go into this awesome holy place. And I guess we can have a similar experience. We can come to church and in the same sort of way feel like it's been years and years and years since we actually had a message from God, since we actually heard him speak to us. We can feel like it's gone generations past since we had a message from God. But one of the great teachings of the New Testament is that the great curtain behind that altar is torn. God isn't tucked up in a sacred holy place. He's everywhere. God is someone you can meet all the time, in any part of your day, when you're shopping at Woolworths, when you're driving your car, when you're working at home, when you're in your garden, and when you're at church. It's not something that you have to wait for. It's something that's around us all the time. There was a terrific writer many years ago called Brother Lawrence, a monk, and he wrote a little book called The Practice of the Presence of God. He said, I feel just as closely connected to God in my kitchen washing the dishes as I do in chapel. It's a lovely sort of thought. We don't need to be living in a life where we never expect to meet God. And Zechariah's name is interesting. It has two parts, Zechari at the beginning and this Yah suffix at the end. You see Yah in a lot of Bible names, Isaiah and Jeremiah. It's part of the sacred name of God, Yahweh, and it's attached there, and it usually carries this meaning of God. His name means remembered by God. The Zechari part means remembered by God. And when the angel comes to him, he says, do not be afraid, Zechariah, remembered by God. Your prayer has been heard. Not the prayer you were just praying. Not that prayer as you poured out the incense and the oil on the altar and burnt it. Not that prayer. That other one. You know the one I mean? The one from years and years ago. The one you and Elizabeth have prayed so many times. That prayer has been heard. You see, Zechariah and Elizabeth were childless and now very old. Maybe he had a 1 in 18,000 chance of his name being drawn by lot to represent people before God in the temple, but it seems he had far less chance of becoming a father in his extreme old age. The irony of his name, I guess, is that Zechariah didn't feel like he'd been remembered by God. He felt like he'd been ignored by God and forgotten, and worse than just ignored or forgotten or sidelined, actually disapproved of by God. To be without children was a shameful thing and a sign of God's disapproval. And maybe in his story there had been years and years of sorrow and shame and of praying that prayer. And since their old age had come, and since his wife Elizabeth was no longer having a feminine cycle, maybe they'd long ago given up even praying that prayer, even asking God for the child. Zechariah, remembered by God. The other Bible name with a similar first syllable is Zacchaeus. His name means pure, and there's a lot of irony there too, because Zacchaeus was anything but pure. He was a tax collector, which meant he was a traitor to his people, to the people of God, a traitor to the hated Romans who had ruled over them with an iron fist. And by his own admission, he even cheated at that, and the ones he cheated were his own people. He says in his story, if I've cheated anyone, I'll pay back four times what I owe. And then there he is paying back four times what he owes. So he must have cheated people. But after he met Jesus, he changed. His whole life changed. And Jesus says of him, righteousness has come to this house. He met Jesus and he was made new, and he fulfilled the prophecy of his own name. He became a person who was pure. In the same way, Zechariah 2 meets God's messenger there beside the altar of incense with the gold and the frankincense and the myrrh. And in meeting him and in having this prophecy and in bearing this child, Zechariah is made new. And that old, old dream, that dusty dream that he'd probably given up on when it seemed no longer biologically possible for Elizabeth to bear a child, when she was past the age of childbearing, that dream got to fly. It got to go out. There was a little hitch. There was a little hitch in his faith when Zechariah doubted the angel's words, and he asks that how question. How can I be sure of what you're saying? Before you're too hard on Zechariah on account of that, it's good to look at the whole story. It's good to remember that for years, maybe thousands of times, he and Elizabeth had prayed for a child. I am sure they did. And that's a very wearing experience, to pray over and over and over again for something and to feel like it's never given to you. And to be a childless person who is also a priest is a contradiction in terms. It's full of shame to not have children. It's like a sign of God's disapproval back then. All sorts of people could have children. People, foreigners in other countries, you know, there were prostitutes in the country who would have children. But to be a priest and not have a child was a shocking stamp of God's disapproval of you. It's probable that Zacharias and Elizabeth, having prayed for such a long time, having started out in their married life, was full of a joyful hope that they would have a child, and maybe an expectation. And then, you know, their friends would say things to them about a baby coming along. And as the months and months rolled around and every month they realized she was not pregnant again, they might have moved from hope to anxiety. And in the end, they might have dreaded that monthly recognition that once again she wasn't pregnant, wasn't going to have a child, and once again a sense of dread and defeat would have come up in their life, and their spiritual lives would have become a battlefield between prayer and faith and disappointed hope and longing. They would have been riddled with guilt, saying to themselves, why is it that we don't have a child? What have we done wrong? How have we not pleased God? You sort of can't be a priest who represents people to God without God's approval. You know, you can't come before God and bring everyone's prayers and offer the incense and represent the people and ask God to forgive sins if you yourself are so filled with the sense that you are a disappointment to God, that you have his disapproval. This sort of experience for them would have been enough to throw doubt into the most resolute of hearts. For a long lifetime, all the career of his priestly life, Zechariah and Elizabeth had been disappointed in this way. And remember what happens in the story. They're given a little boy, a child, and they name him John. And just like the angel says, he will be a joy and a delight to you. And I believe that he was. He says that many people will rejoice in his birth, and he will be called great, that the Holy Spirit will be upon him even before he's born, that he's going to have a spirit-filled ministry, and it will be an effective ministry in turning people to God, that he will go on and minister before God in the spirit of Elijah, and he will fulfill the prophecy of Isaiah to prepare a way for the coming of the Messiah. Just beautiful things come to Zechariah at this time of his life. He is filled with joy and delight because of the baby that's born. And he himself is filled with the Holy Spirit as the baby is born and they're going to name him. He makes a prophecy and he's vindicated by God. His son is born. His dead hope is brought back to life. His duty as a priest is perfected. His shame was lifted. His dreams of being a father were elevated more than he could ever have imagined. And his own faith is restored. And remember the angel's first words to him. He says, do not be afraid, Zechariah, you who are remembered by God. Your prayer has been heard. And I think someone with Zechariah's life experience and faith journey needed to hear that. I think Elizabeth needed to hear that. Your prayer has been heard. They had long lived with the sense that their prayers had not been heard, that they were sidelined by God. And the angel says to him, your prayer has been heard. You are remembered by God. It's a beautiful idea. It's worth pondering. And as we finish up today, perhaps you could take these three thoughts with you that we can learn from this little chunk of Luke chapter 1. Expect to meet God. The teaching of the New Testament is that the curtain is torn. God is not someone who only lives in holy places, but he lives all over the earth and he lives with us. You can go through your life tuning yourself to listen to him and to expect to hear him guiding you. You can take the words that the angel said to Zechariah as a direct message to you. Do not be afraid, you who are remembered by God. Your prayer is heard. The prayers that matter most in your life, the prayers that have grieved you, even the prayers that you have long since ceased to pray. Your prayer has been heard. And the last thing I think is good for us to remember as we get older, Zechariah's big moment, his big moment of faith, of meeting God, of seeing God at work in his life, came at the end. The same is true for people like Simeon and the prophetess Anna, who were in the courtyard when Jesus was dedicated. A long human life, but their big moment came right near the end. We are never too old. We're never too old to meet God and to discover that he can bring our dreams to life and that he has heard the prayers we've prayed, even if we've stopped praying them and stopped believing they could happen. Amen.